good stuff, I think, which the other one's more application so far. I think everybody knows what computer science is. Thank you to Rev Human and Michael Paladino for sponsoring the event and the location. What we're here to talk about today is an introduction to OCaml, thunks, streams, and types for streams, evaluation strategies such as looking at strict versus non-strict or eager versus lazy. OCaml tends to be an eager evaluator unless you implement something that makes it lazy, whereas other languages, very few other languages, but some other languages like Haskell default to being lazy. We're going to look at monads, and throughout the whole thing, I think it's important about discussing being somewhat precise. And by that I mean this, like for example, not that it's really germane to this at all, but sometimes people use the word nil and sometimes people use the word null, and it's important to differentiate the difference between the two, which is a revelation that I've had fairly recently that they're not interchangeable, and in fact one is a noun and one is an adjective. Nil is a noun and null is an adjective to be applied to other things. So you could have null x, x the noun is null, but a thing itself is nil. Nil is just a value that's a noun. And so there's some things going through here that I think would be good to really take that kind of approach, like the things like the difference between an applicative programming language or construct and functional, because usually the two are used interchangeably, but they're slightly different things. And assignment versus name binding, because most languages have something that looks like you're allowing something to fulfill some other concept, or you name something. But in a lot of imperative languages, that's actually assignment, and in most functional type languages, it's more of a name binding thing. One of the reasons why it's fun to look at applicative or functional programming languages is new ways to think about computing stuff and new ways to think about the problems in general. And really one of the reasons there's a lot of efforts in functional programming is because you have provability that the algorithms do what they say they're going to do, because you don't have any side effects. And most of the structures are sort of algebraic structures that you can have a formal proof having to deal with, whereas imperative languages, unless you can establish an equivalence to a functional algorithm, you don't really have much opportunity for guaranteeing the performance. Also looking at some fun tools, which I think are really mainly useful for this, so that we can go through a bunch of code without having to copy paste or do anything weird or type at all. So I'm going to use Vim, and we're going to use tmux because tmux is awesome. And with tmux you can use the kind of typical like control characters to split the screen or create new screens and whatnot. Or tmux can be used sort of in the background by calling the tmux command. So if you're using Vim, you can set up things to bind keys to operations that will control tmux. So you can do all sorts of really cool stuff where you can select a region and send it to a different display panel, or pane as they call it. So we're going to use Vim Slime, which is a Vim variant of a tool for Emacs that does the same thing. And what I did was I made this little VV script. It just stands for vertical view. And then it takes the argument, the code, and it'll split the screen, launch our little replica on one side, and have Vim running on the other side. And since coding.com uses screen, and then you're running tmux inside screen, it's a little squirrely, so you have to remap some keys to make it work right. But in any case, what you can do is you can have your code over here, and you can go Control-C, Control-C, and send it over to the other pane. And it's really awesome for this, because that way we can just kind of go through here and do stuff. But it's also really handy for debugging stuff, because if you're just typing into the REPL, it's sort of annoying to to go back and try to edit your stuff. So if you can just ping back and forth on the panes and send the code over, it's really quite handy. So I don't really know how long this is going to take for this presentation, or if we're going to fly through it, or if we're going to dwell on anything, or what. It's probably the least prepared presentation-wise, but it's the most scripted, so I guess we'll see. Anyway, so first thing off was for basic OCaml, if you want to do something of name binding, you just say let some name equal whatever you want it to be. Over on your REPL, it'll tell you what you did. It'll say x was an integer and it equals 5. And one of the distinctions is that's not really assignment. There's nothing in memory that's being given this value, integer 5. So you can't look it up anywhere. There is the abstract idea that something named x that's going to get used later happens to have the name 5. But it's not like in other languages, like if you've been program in C or something, you would have a variable and it would have a specific allocated place for that variable and you could use it again and again. It's a throwaway construct that the compiler uses that just does the naming. And you can do the same thing with functions and you can have them somewhat imperative style in the declaration. Add x and y is equal to adding x and y. Pretty similar to most languages. And if you're wanting to do scoping, n is a scoping token. So add xy is equal to xy in the following function, add 5, 5. So with this guy.
Come, can you zoom slightly?
Zoom?
Is that a
I don't know.
Possible thing?
The browser should let you, unless it's got some crazy responsive.
You can do a command plus also if you.
It's like you're on a different machine.
Yeah,
or something.
It's got the crazy responsive thing where even if you zoom, it minimizes.
I'm bad.
Is that burning you off too bad?
It's messing the TMUX, that's for sure. Oh, there we go. All right.
Usually,
it's great.
They just need a little.
So there's no difference between let add x, y equal x plus y and using the function declarator. Or whatever that is.
It just says the name later on until it goes out of scope. The name
gotcha.
Add is going to be this, X is going to be this.
Gotcha.
So what ultimately happens, not that I've ever really written this down anywhere in this presentation, but you generate a big expression and then evaluate the entire expression. So when somebody says something about it being an applicative language, when it's going to evaluate it, it just applies it. If you have add 5, 5, it knows what add means. It's 5 plus 5. And so you just do a bunch of substitutions. Compiler does a bunch of substitutions until the point where everything is ready to evaluate and then chains the evaluations back up. Unlike an imperative language where things are being set in memory, arguments are being taken, something very physical happens with them. Also, in most functional languages, function declaration is usually passed by value, so the notion of the value will be passed to it. It might have to chain further and compute something until it can actually do the computation, but in most imperative languages, it's passed by reference. If you had something, say, in Ruby or something that said add xy, you're going to pass two pointers, one for something that's an x and one for something that's the second value y. And then it will use those two, and I mean, you know, the magic of knowing what the types are would happen and so forth, but it would be a reference. Whereas here, the only thing that ever happens is you build out a huge expression. And so when people say applicative, it usually means those kind of things. It's a language that generally would be passed by value and generally will build out a huge expression for the answer and then evaluate it all at once. The functional part has more to do with if functions can be passed and if functions behave as like any other value. And they're synonymous almost because in almost every language that's functional, it's applicative, and in almost every applicative language, functions would behave in the kind of functional way where they can be used like any other value. So an alternate way to declare add xy is you can just say, sort of in an anonymous style way, it's a function x, y, and it is equal to x plus y. And OCaml is really great because you can, but don't have to be explicit about types. So you could very easily say that x and y are integers and this function returns an integer. And that can be relatively handy for humans. The OCaml uses a fairly fancy automatic typing system, so it will figure out what you meant to do. It'll notice, like in the first add, x, y, that add was taking two integers, and clearly the result would be an integer, so it won't flag you on that there was something bad going on there. But you can be explicit about it.
What happens if you add, after adding two integers, does it infer that those are ints, or does it? Okay, so then if you try to add a float or something after that?
Yeah, if you did a float, then you would have trouble with doing it this way. It's for some reason, it doesn't always say what the problems are.
Right.
Anyway, the type system will catch it. The type system.
Based on whatever passed in was passed to the first one.
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting way of doing it.
And it would know in the first one, too, even if you weren't explicit about it, that the add operation is that OCaml does not do overloaded operators. So you have an explicit operator for integer versus floating point and so forth. And kind of like you would use one with a dot after it, the syntax for the commands for like the infix operators have a dot, like it's plus dot if it's a floating point. So it would know this is something that needs two floating point numbers or two integers. And you gave me one floating point and one integer, and that's just not going to work out. One thing that's really awesome with OCaml, and I suppose nicely typed languages in general, is what I found anyway, is basically if you can get it to get through the type system, the only error is something about your problem.
Right.
You'll never have something like, oh my gosh, it looks like my program works, and then I tried to, you know, you just don't get it, like never. You have some struggles getting through the type system sometimes, but once you're there, your problem either works or it doesn't work, but the program itself works every time. You don't have operator overloading, but you do have polymorphic parameters. So you can say these little tick fellows, like tick A and so forth, it's just some type. It's really supposed to stand for alpha in the Greek characters, but it's some kind of list. If you're appending things, you don't really want it where append doesn't work on anything. You'd like it to work on anything you want. I have some list and I want to append some other list to it. I don't really care if it's integers or strings or what it is. So you can use the polymorphic types for that, for parameters. And they always work just dandy. So the functional thing, functions are first class, which means you can use functions for as values for anything. So list.map, the list function will, across all of the items in a list, do the function operation that's specified. So we can just say double is a function that takes x and multiplies it by 2. And you end up with 2, 4, 6. And so whenever people say functions are first class, it just means you can use them anywhere. And there's higher order functions, which we're kind of combining this a little bit with, So if we defined add in the same way we did before, it's just two things added together, I can make a new function that's built out of a piece of that. If add is x plus y, I can say add 2 is add 2. And whenever it gets built into a real expression, add 2 and 10 is, or the add 2, like this add 2 with a 10, would just get replaced with add 2 and then a 10 after it. So anytime you can do that sort of thing, you can take a function of multiple variables and write little chunks based on it, that's really kind of handy because you can make little pieces that you would use and you go on a short form for or something, and it just works flawlessly. And this is basically a good intro to currying, because if you were able to do this like higher order function, basically there's sort of this grouping that's going on. Add x and y being x plus y, if you can break it up, it's pretty clear that the way it evaluates it is looking at what happened to the first argument and then addressing the second argument. So if you can define it like another, yet another equivalent add statement would be, it's a function of x that maps to a function of y that happens to be x plus y. And it's somewhat like scoping. You've got some function taking a value x, and the next one adds that next thing. So you can do exactly the same thing like that. And it's probably more used, I would suspect, kind of going the other way. If you've got something that takes multiple arguments, then a lot of times you could use your currying idea to break that into simpler problems. And people, I mean, adds an excellent example of doing that, I guess, because really what's happening with add is you're taking one value and applying it to the result of the next computation. And the next computation is just getting that next value and doing the add operation to it. So one of the benefits, I guess, with some of the functional programming like this is you really have a lot of flexibility in what you're doing and how you're representing it. You can use a style that looks somewhat imperative. You can use a style that looks anonymous. You can use a style that looks curried. And you can make sort of fractional functions out of things pretty easily. And if you want to have something, really this let rec means it's recursive factorial. And the funny thing with rec is it doesn't really do anything. The only thing it does is adjust what the scoping is. Within this scoped after you defined let rec, if you used factorial again, it wouldn't go off looking for some random other factorial function. It would allow it to use the one that you're defining. And there are some things that you can't really define that don't make sense for the type system as recursive functions, but for the most part, things behave sort of as you would anticipate them to. And the all-important matching is something that is really good in OCaml and a lot of languages. It's a really cheesy example, but if you matched x with 1, it would give you 1, or any other number n, it would give you the formula for a factorial. And one of the reasons why I'm doing this way, define the factorial in evaluating it, is it's kind of a handy pattern and it modularizes some of this stuff. So I'm not really polluting the global space of defined names with factorial because I'm using factorial in something that evaluates it and then all of it gets thrown away after. Most every Lisp-like language has built-in lists. And lists are a construction that is a value, and what you might think of kind of like linked list style is a value in something along the lines of a pointer to another one of these things. And it could be empty, because lists can terminate. You can have nothing in a list, it's just plain empty. You have one, and then the next item is empty. And this will become important when we look at the streams and stuff, because those don't terminate. They're basically infinite list representations. But for now, we can just sort of do this by hand. There's internal to any of these languages that support this, there's sort of the same kind of functionality built in already, but there probably isn't even much of a performance penalty doing it yourself, making homemade ones. One thing that's really nice is using these disjunctive types, because you have some polymorphic type alpha list, and it's either empty or it's a construction of a value and the self-referencing list itself. or the self-reference of type itself. So if you want to find the thing that's kind of using the normal language for it, the first element's the head and the rest of it's the tail, you can match this list as either the cons of a head and a, we don't care what it is, because we're not ever going to return it. So we can match it with the cons of a head and a blank, a throwaway variable. And if it's that, then we're just going to return the head. And the thing is, if you're finding the head of something and it was empty, it makes no sense. There is really no answer for it's a head of an empty. Same thing with tail. It's an invalid case. The only reason this is here is because the type checker would complain about not matching every possible thing. So generally what you do in OCaml is you would match, usually match everything. And if there's some cases like this that don't make any sense, match it so you don't get type checker complaints. If you want the tail, you do kind of the same thing, just match it, and then you keep the tail, who cares what the head was. In this case, we're defining them and we're going to use them later, so I need to execute these. If I want to find the nth thing of where the I, that's hard to distinguish from the L, the second thing, the I and then L. I is like, I'm going to use it like nth five and then some list, and I want the fifth thing out of the list. You could just match the L and see what it is. And if I was zero, then return the head. Otherwise, recursively do it with I minus one, because that way you're pinching off the next thing every time, pinching the head off and evaluating the tail and decrementing the number. So if it wasn't, you're looking for the fifth one of this stuff, chop the head off, look for the fourth one, chop the head off, look for the third one. Pick I, that, what does that do? That constructs something that picks a number of things. You would pick three out of the list and it would give you the first three or whatever. I'll post all this code so we can kind of just, unless there's a question or something, zoom through it, because some of the, like, how pick works wasn't really the intent of the presentation. Map is, so, you know, we want all of these kind of normal features. If I'm given a list L and a function F, then I'd like to be able to map that. I mean, and it's also kind of just to show a lot of this stuff that's sort of these basic features on lists are really, really easy. You just go through that list and look at the head, map the head to the new thing with half of the head, and then recurse on the tail. Also, we'll see these about enough times for everybody to be sick of it, because we'll do them here as kind of a base case with regular lists, and then we'll do it for using thunk streams, and then we'll do it for lazy types, and I'll be shot by the time it's over for doing it so many times. Then filter. We'd like to pick something out of the list. If we match the filter condition, then we'll include it. If we don't, then we don't include it. So you can cons the thing onto processing the tail of it if it's something you want. And if you don't, then don't bother with that and just do the tail of it. All right, so I wrote some tests. That's, OCaml is kind of a nice language, having a lot of assert and testing stuff sort of built in. One thing I think with doing this by hand is it's a little bit clunky doing these, building things out. We'll let X be the cons of 5 and empty, so it's just like a singleton list with 5 in it. And we want to know if the head is 5. And it will say, what would happen is it'll either return unit, which is a type that basically is meaningless, somewhat like nil or something, or else it would pitch a fit about it and say, you know, some kind of type mismatch or this thing didn't assert correctly. We could say, if we want to look at the tail, we can build something that's a cons of 5 and empty, and then stuff that into a 10 and that. So it's basically 10-5 as a list. And it was built that way so we could take the tail and know what it was. And it's true. And then if I wanted to find the second item out of a list that goes 0, 1, 2, second item, kind of zero index, kind of second item, then we test out nth. If I want to pick these, the funny thing is I constructed the results different than how we put them together here. So if I had 2, 4, 6 and wanted to pick 2, I actually built a kind of built-in regular list instead of this kind of list. And it works. And if we wanted to map 2, 4 with something that doubles it, we don't get any errors. And if we wanted to filter 2, 4, 6 for only those things that match 4, then we get the thing that has only the 4 in it. So that's kind of how lists in general and most functional languages work. Muck around with heads and tails and deconstructing things and then reconstructing them. So a couple things I thought would be fun to look at on the REPL side. If we had the number 5, it will say it's an int that is 5. If we have string word, it will say it's a string word. And here's this guy. So just to open and close parentheses, it's this unit fellow that's somewhat like nil in other languages. If I want to name x or allow x to use the number 45, be representing it, and I just enter that, then it'll say the value of x is the integer 45. And then if I, you know, I can check it, x is the integer 45. Here's kind of the funny construct that makes some of these suspensions for infinite lists work. Instead, you could say let x be a function that takes this kind of bogus unit value, and that maps to 45. And then I could say, well, what's x? Well, it's a unit maps to an integer. It's a function where the unit maps to an integer. So it's kind of fun because now x is not the value. X is something that you can get the value out of, but it's not just the value. You have to send it an argument, the non-event unit argument, in order to get the value out. So that's kind of fun though because it's almost like you sort of stored it like in a register. There's something and you can pass an additional bogus value and get your value back, but it is not your value. So if you're making a stream, a stream type is almost the same thing, except there's no empty because it doesn't terminate. And instead of being a construction of a value and then the type, it's a construction of unit mapping to the type. So you can kind of see where it's going already. You're going to build things where whenever you give it an argument again, the unit argument, you'll get the next value, and then the next value. So it halts it. It's kind of a, puts the brakes on every time until you pass it an argument. So if you wanted a something that represents an infinite series of ones, you could have a recursive definition for ones that's a construction of one, and then a function of unit mapping to ones. And that's one of the kind of things that you'd almost not suspect would work with the type checker, but it does. Probably most of these you'd almost not would suspect wouldn't work because you'd think they would evaluate. You can't do that if it's a regular type because, I mean like a regular list, because that won't type check correctly. It'll try to apply it. If you let rec ones equal cons of ones, one the number comma ones as a regular list, it would try to build out the infinite list. But since you have it having to take an argument to get the next value, it kind of halts the problem. So you can define infinite sequences and evaluate them step by step. And if you wanted the natural numbers, this guy, increment I, just takes I and then starts incrementing it by incrementing it again. And Fibonacci just does the Fibonacci's. Here's where it's starting to look like I'm going to be in trouble. So if we wanted to do the head, it's almost identical. I didn't do it like with match like before, because we don't have the type checker problem with the empty, because we don't have empty. So we can do a simpler matching. We can just let columns of head and some throwaway value equal the string we're looking for, and then return the head. Whoa, that was curious. Same thing with tail. I mean, they're almost identical. The basic algorithm of them is the same thing, except when you're looking at a tail, since you had to define the tail section having the unit mapping, you have to evaluate T unit every time. And that's really the only difference, is when you're defining a series, you have the function that takes unit mapping to whatever, and whenever you're wanting to evaluate it, you have to evaluate that thunk. That little scheme where you have a function taking unit mapping to some value is called a thunk, because it always has been. I don't really know why the word choice, but I think it's sort of a play on think, because you think sort of in the present tense about something, but you had previously thought, I want to let x equal 5. And then later on, you had thunk it in the past, so you can say x unit and get the 5 back. So I did the exact same things as before, and aside from not doing it with match, since we don't need match, they're basically the same thing. And then for some of these tests, I made like a couple helper functions for us, something that increments, something that doubles something, and something that returns true and false based on if it's evens or odds. The thing I like about these tests, if you're doing stuff like this, is amazingly enough, when you're using streams, all the code with your streams is like way nicer looking.
Yeah.
It's not near as clunky as all this cons this and cons that nonsense. I want to know what the first element of ones is, and it's just nice looking. It's true, yeah, it's a one. The first element of the last element of ones is a one. I want to pick three ones, and I got three ones. Pick three naturals, get the first three. Pick some Fibonacci's, get them. And then it really works well for applying a lot of functions to it. I want to pick three of map the increment function to the ones, so I should get three twos. I want to double the naturals. I want to filter out, pick the first three filtered even naturals. So whatever the even naturals are, I want to pick the first three so I get 0, 2, 4. And it almost reads like in English, whereas the plain list, at least if you're using hand construction, really is clunky looking. But you have this kind of extraordinary expressiveness if you're using these, because the functions apply the way you want them to and seem natural. And I mean, it's almost like if you were in grade school and you were wanting something to just work the way you thought it would. Pick the first three double natural numbers, 0, 2, 4. And there they are. You can do things on two streams. There's nothing wrong with doing things on two or three or however many streams. You just have to do the deconstruction and construction a little fancier. So if you wanted to map f, a function f onto two streams, there's no reason you can't do that, and it will return just a stream where they're merged and mapped. I'm not doing tests, not dwelling on them, just wanted to show that you can have it execute and it doesn't pitch a fit with errors about it. Oh, maybe there were tests for it. So you can have add be the regular add, and choose is mapping the add function on two sequences of ones. And if you picked some of those guys, then you just get the twos. Or you wanted to use the merge function that merges two streams, one that's ones and one that's twos. The way that was set up is it would alternate them. So it would pick one of them out of the first one, then the second. So you can always take these streams and make a new stream out of it. Some of the troubles with these streams are that, what are the troubles? The troubles are you don't have memoization, so you have performance problems. By the time you get to evaluating the 10th natural number, you evaluated this, then you evaluated this. There's a lot of, yeah, you waste a lot of time with this scheme without memoization. But you have good provability that the stuff's going to work. You know exactly what it's going to do, and you can represent infinite things and evaluate them one by one. And since you can do that, you can pick the first 10 or whatever you want out of it. So one of the reasons a person uses lazy typing, like the traditional lazy typing, is if you use lazy typing, it's like a built-in sort of thing in most languages. You're automatically, they take care of giving you memoization. And your performance is a lot better. As you run the risk of, well, what if I used an enormous amount of memory and I never destroyed this thing that I was thinking about? You can get memory leaks by doing this, but it's probably worth the trouble. And it's easy. It's made to be easy. And there's nothing preventing somebody from writing their own lazy thing that does the memoization, but I decided not going to do that for here. If you're using the OCaml lazy type, it's basically the same thing, except you use the lazy T type instead of doing the homemade thunk thing. And instead of having a function that maps unit to ones, you just say, it's lazy. The ones are lazy. Let rec ones be the construction of a one and some more of these lazy ones. Whoa, that did not a bunch. Do play, but I could thought it would. It still works. I don't know why that one likes to print a lot. Same with Fibonacci's. These guys are almost the same thing. The only real difference is anytime you have to mess with the tail where you had said that it was going to be lazy, lazy.force forces it to evaluate it and memoize it. So anytime you call lazy.force, like say you were doing the natural numbers, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, when you lazy.force the 4, it'll know what that is immediately the next time it wants that one. So you'll never have to muck around with evaluating the entire string of stuff. There's a alternate to lazy.force that does not force it and memoize it, but I can't claim that anyone probably ever uses that because you don't get any benefit from it. So the only real meaningful difference on here is that it had been like T unit evaluating the T, say on the nth one with lazy.force T, and now it's lazy.force T. So no meaningful difference between the two, other than how the thunk and the lazy is done. We still have those fancy helper functions from before, so we can try these out and see if they work or pitch a fit. Or I could skip to the end and people could believe me that they passed, but, you know, can't trust this stuff. So it works the same. And you have all of the expressiveness, but now you have memoization and better performance at slight risk of memory leaks.
So is the memoization, so say you did the memoization lazy force on the tail list, or whatever, the end, the last input, the hardest to calculate, so to speak. Is that going to memoize all of the preceding elements as well?
Well, the one before it would have done
It would. It calculates each one, so.
So the first one will
it
calculate
calls lazy
the first
each
one.
Time, yeah.
And then as you go, it's kind of fun because, like, if you think about how it would do with a list, if you are, you would like your list to evaluate in big O of n time because it's n whatever's long, or you're interested in the first n. I guess the sequence represents infinite, but you're interested in the first n, so it ought to evaluate in n time. If you're doing the thunk method that doesn't have the memoization, you do the first one, great, and then you're doing rework, And you're doing rework on the whole thing, so you really end up with an n squared problem if you're doing just thunks with no memoization. So it makes for little bitty problems like what's the, you know, 5 factorial, no one would ever know the difference, but you can, all you've got to do on that factorial is put 20. It about 20, yeah. And the rep will never return.
Yeah, very large, very quickly.
And, of course, why would you not be able to do lazy streams on these? Because with multiple streams, combining them and so forth, because it had nothing to do with whether it was thunks or lazy. It had more to do with how you deconstruct and construct stuff. So you could do the same stuff again. Nothing's going to break. In most languages, I would say, OCaml and I suppose F-sharp probably has lazy stuff. There's some differences between F-sharp and OCaml, but it's not these sorts of things. And probably standard ML. And I don't, you know, things like that. They all have lazy as an option, but not by default. They all want to eager evaluate things by default, unless you decided that what you wanted to do was have lazy lists. Haskell stands out a little bit on its own because by default everything in Haskell is lazy unless you specify otherwise that you want it to eager evaluate. So it's kind of, it's interesting because Haskell can be really expressive because you get all of these benefits. I just want ones. Let me make a lazy infinite list of stream of ones. And you have this great expressive code, but it's interesting that most languages take the approach that you want to eager evaluate, and Haskell takes the approach that you want to lazy evaluate everything. So you can get into performance problems with Haskell, just like you could with anything, because the language is built around the idea that you want to do that problem very simply and by default, unless you specify otherwise. That's all there is to the list stuff and lazy lists and all that kind of stuff. And at first, it was going to be maybe we'd do this monad business, maybe not. But then while I was making this up, it seemed like this probably didn't take that long to do the lists. And the monads are really kind of cool too. So, and they're kind of, it's not totally clear what the best way to start is. So I was going to blabber for a minute about the sort of mathy side, and then look at the kind of motivating why you would care about this sort of thing, and then we'll make a couple monads that are maybe semi-useful. So in the maths, you have things like rings and groups and so forth, and there's another kind of entity like that that is something that is has to do with mapping categories, and sort of the larger idea in that is an item called a monoid. And a monoid, you have a set, and you have, all you need to have with it is there's a binary operation that preserves being in the set. Something in this category cross, some other thing in this category stays there, and it has an identity element. So that's pretty vague, but if you have an operation in that set that maps to itself, you call this thing an endofunctor, because functors map categories to themselves. So if it maps to itself, then it's an endofunctor, and you have natural transformations, is what people call them. One that's binary composition, so you take a functor that takes two things from our monad, and it ends up being something in the monad and an identity. So it's kind of similar to the monoids. Monoids have an identity and they have a binary operation. Monads have the same things, except their mappings into themselves. So like as a example, a functor, you can take some module in OCaml and use a functor to map it to some other module. So you can have a collection of functions in a module and map it to some other collection of functions, that could not be a monad because it's not something that's mapping to the same module that it's already in. So if you have something that maps to the same module, there's something that will take two arguments and map into it, and there's some notion of an identity, then you have a monad. What you have in practice, if it follows sort of the more mathy definition, is you have a function generally called fmap and one called join. But in practice, people usually use two functions that are equivalent called bind and return. And bind takes a value and monadifies it, and bind performs an operation on a monad with a non-monad value. So here's some reason why you might like monads. You want to have division that's optionalized. In a lot of these languages, you can have a value, and you can have some of it or none of it, or different languages use different keywords for that. But what you might do if you were doing division and you had a numerator and a denominator, if the denominator was zero, we know that it would have a math fault. So we could protect against it. If the denominator is zero, we'll return none. There's no way to accomplish this division. Otherwise, we can return sum of whatever the result is. So for example, 5 divided by 2 would give you sum 2.5. But if you did div op 5, 0, it would say none. Can't do it. Kind of a variation maybe on like having an exception or something that you were testing for. But if you did something like you wanted to chain it up, I want to first do this inner division of 5 and 2 and then divide that again by 5 or 2. Oh snap. This guy has type float option because it would have been sum 2.5, but divopt, the function, doesn't take optionalized arguments. It only takes plain old 5.5 or whatever, 5.5. So what you could do is you can define a function bind that takes m for monad, and it matches the monad, well, and it also takes the function f. It matches the monad with, if there's sum of it, then it'll map it to f evaluated of, at that, with that x, and none maps to none. And there's this, people seem to have incredible trouble with the name return for monad stuff. Return, rightly so, return takes a non-monad and returns a monad, whereas you would kind of think maybe it returns a value to you. It's your way to monadify something. So if you had a number x, then it just would give you some x. And so this will be a monad for division that's optionalized. And it basically is just optionalizing a number. If we did this, we can write divopt using bind and return in this way that's probably not necessarily worth scrutinizing too much, but you're defining the f that was up there as a function of x that binds it again, so you're basically doing two binds because you have two arguments for division. And now, you can divide 5 and 2. You can divide the thing that has the second one, you get 1.25. And if you did something that had an error in it and gave none, then it would propagate the none back to you. So now you can actually do division the way you want, even though it has the options in it. What's often done is this business up there with all these functions that are mapping is kind of clunky and awful looking, so it's really common to use greater than equal to represent bind. It seems kind of like a Haskellism. And then you can have this function f, don't need to stuff it all in the same place. F x y does what we wanted it to do. And then you can write div opt a lot more compactly. there, OCaml doesn't do this by default, whereas Haskell and some languages do, but they have an alternate way of doing these declarations that use a do notation that looks a lot more imperative than this. So it still works, even though we defined it this other way. It's a lot less clunky looking. But before, there was talk about how this is sort of a modular thing. So we'll sort of have a module, and we'll include everything that we want for this to do our division. Basically, this first stuff is the same as we saw before. And it's a lot of times the case that you're doing things that take two arguments like this. So a common function to kind of help that not suck as much is to define this lift function that does that stuff. So lift did exactly what we did with diffopt, except we're just going to use this f that does the division. And because we can, because OCaml allows you to define all sorts of crazy things as functions, things that are like symbols that are not alphabetic or infix operators. So if you did anything that's like a regular math function, divide, or plus plus, or whatever, could be an infix operator, as well as like the greater than equal thing. So this is where it's a little tricky to get this to work. So we have to highlight it since there's breaks in it, and then shoot this over there. So now we have a module. And one of the nice things, I think, with OCaml is, so you have a module, and I want to use this fancy new optionalized division thing. I can just let this be what it was from in the module. I can let R be the return thing. And now I can do this kind of sort of like it's a more palatable operation anyway. I can do all this optionalized arithmetic very easily. I've got a division symbol that's a little bit funky, but means optionalized division. And I know I've got to turn all my stuff into monads, so R is pretty concise. So that's maybe one motivation. You want to do some kind of problem that involves applying a normal operation to some funny thing like having options for it. Then I thought probably the next best thing would be to do the cheesiest monad possible, which is the identity one. So all you've got are pass throughs. You're binding a monad and a function, and it's a function of the monad. Return x just gives you x, and we'll use our friendly little greater than equal as bind. So we'll use that. Now what we could do is, if I had a function add n that takes a number n, it's a function that'll return to me the return value of x plus n. And I did that just to kind of reinforce that we've got these fun higher order functions. So add 5, we can just add n a 5. But the fun thing with this is, since it's basically an identity, and we've got this infix operator that does the return stuff, if I want to add 5, I've got this really curious syntax for doing it, but I can have the number 1, and then our little infix operator that we know we basically is a monad that just sort of is an identity, and then add 5 is a function that will return the thing with 5 added to it. Or the nice thing is you can chain all this stuff up. The first time it evaluates it, it gives you the identity monad, and you can do it again, and you get 11. So some things, like if you were, I don't know, maybe an analog would be, maybe you wrote a class that allowed you to do method chaining, because every method returned self or something like that, so that you could do this sort of stuff. It's sort of similar to that you can chain a lot of this stuff up. You could define a whole ton of functions based on the identity monad, and then you can chain them all up to do things. So the last one that was in here, I've got one more having to do with lists, and then the last one with side effects. Maybe we'll skip to the last one first, because it is basically the identity. Again. So a variation on this theme that's used a lot. If you delete it, is one thing Haskell does that's real interesting is in order to make everything that has a side effect look like functional programming, like you don't want to ever see printf or anything like that because your computer wouldn't be a real computer if you had printf, is almost everything that has a side effect like IO and printing and stuff like that is bundled up in a monad. So basically some of those things are pretty much equivalent to this, which is basically the identity monad, except it has printf stuffed inside it. So from our perspective here, we have this funny symbol being the printf monad, and return is just our normal kind of return thing. But what happens internally, I mean, it chains up this identity monad, but every time it prints out whatever that argument was, or whatever that value for the thing was. So you can make this thing that looks sort of kind of like C out and C++ that will just take a whole big string of things and it'll print out the sentence for you. So when you're looking at Haskell and how they do monads, almost everything that might look like it's some kind of IO or side effect gets bundled up that way. And I think it's a neat way to do it, but it's also a little bit of a ruse because, of course, it's going to print something. And the language does print stuff, but the interface to doing it doesn't really seem like it's something that prints. It seems like it's entirely functional the whole way. And this guy here is a kind of standard list-related monad that basically it's very much like the identity, except it applies things to lists. So if we added n, then it would add n to every element of the list. So the add 5 one applies it to everything in the list. 1, 2 turns into 6, 7, and if it was, done in a repeated fashion, then it turned into 11, 12. So you can make a monad that does almost anything for you. You want something that operates on every element of a list, you want something that prints stuff out, you want something that is an identity so that you can define your own function on things and have a way to chain up things and have a continuation. Some people use the word continuation with monads if they're done this way, because you can continuously just do something and do something and do something to it. And that's basically all I've got. There's lists, and they're fun, and streams, and they're fun, and they're probably better if you use the memoized ones, and they're easy to use. And monads are really kind of interesting construct that are almost never used in any language except for Haskell.
Sorry, earlier you were saying that, so like, you said F sharp, but I'm not sure if it was Haskell or not. You said they did lazy by default.
Haskell does lazy by default.
Haskell. And you said that can lead to performance issues. Is that usually like memory performance issues, or?
It depends on your problem, and the alternatives are not necessarily better. But if you're memoizing, it's like anything. If you were in C and you malloced an enormous amount of memory and you didn't get rid of it, or you're using something with garbage collection, and you there still was something referencing it, it's not going to flush it. If you're building some enormous memoized thing, and you have a lingering reference to it, then you've got a sort of unexpected large memoized thing. On the other hand, if you evaluated it anyway, you'd have a large thing. So the alternative is not necessarily any better, but you could run into some sort of memory issue or memory leak.
Yeah.
And languages like OCaml, you can do value assignment to a variable. It's just, there's not a purpose in it. You generally would like a lot of that hidden inside something that you're using and not do it manually like you usually do in an imperative language, but you can't kid yourself that every language there is assigns values to things at some level or other. I mean, the processor is not something that has any clue about functional programming.
Right, yeah. Yeah, it wasn't built from the ground up for no side effects.
Apparently there have been
functional processors.
Processors that were built for functional programming that caught on about not at all. I don't know about it was a long time ago, too. It wasn't any time recently. It was like in the 80s or something. Some people were playing around with things that were natively better at some of these kind of operations, but who knows what happened with that. But, you know, it's interesting. Some people, it's almost like it's some, I don't want to point at the Haskell people, but it kind of seems to me like they're pretty far gone on functional, and for good reason, because it's fun and it's interesting, and it's fun to write the software, but it really should, it's, there's some problems where it's like a really obvious choice to use a functional language.
Right.
You want to find the first 100 Fibonacci's or stuff like that. I mean, it's like four lines. And a lot of other problems are really great to solve this way too, but some things are just brutal, like OCaml and Haskell both have web frameworks, and they are both god-awful things for the most part that are really clunky looking to
dealing with authentication using purely functional. Well, I mean, so that's the other thing, is that most imperative languages have functional features now, which are really useful.
It seems like
everything seems to merge functional now.
Mm-hmm. All the good aspects of a lot of the types of programming
have
all come together.
Yeah, it's really nice.
It's fun though, because I don't know, like I kind of feel, suppose you had map or something, and map takes some sort of anonymous function or whatever in language of choice that is not a further along on the functional chart kind of language. There's no reason you couldn't have that exact same kind of interface and so forth in almost any language. It has almost nothing to do with being functional, because they aren't necessarily languages that like have very convenient map on arrays or whatever, where you can pass a function in an array and get it back. They don't have to have first class functions. They don't have to have higher order functions. They don't have to evaluate things the same way. It's kind of funny why these languages would not have had that functionality to begin with, because it borrows that you can do it easily and sort of in a nice looking way and expressively from some of the classic functional languages, but there's no good reason why they didn't have that before.
Seems like you can, from what you've showed us anyway, from what I've seen of it, that you can just kind of build the language you need in really concise terms without having to have stuff built into it necessarily.
I think that's really one of the things that's the most fun with some of these languages, is you've got these really simple building blocks, and when you see how you can do the pieces and put them together to make other stuff, if you've got the right kind of language constructs, like you can build things with disjunctive typing. Like I kind of had a negative on the web frameworks for some of these, but they're also incredibly concise for generating a page and taking actions on things. Insanely concise. Like, you can define a template very easily, and then you can apply everything to the template very easily, and then you have something, the web framework provides the kind of normal stuff like, well, match a route and then apply this stuff to it. And it's like the thing that actually would probably be sort of like your controller is maybe like three lines, and then you have a template that's very concise, and they're kind of funny looking beasts, but they're very concise.
So OCaml on Rails?
OCaml has some of the wackiest, I'd say, web framework of any of them, because there's one that's very well known, but the thing that's really, I don't really know why they chose to do this way, but they wanted to do that kind of style where all code for both sides is written in OCaml. So not only is it the web framework, but it has a built-in OCaml compiler that compiles to JavaScript. So you write the front-end code in OCaml, and it builds out JavaScript that does what it says it's going to do.
Wow.
Some of those guys, they just get wild into that stuff, it seems. But there was a statement made by, I don't remember who, probably a long time ago about Lisp, that said something like, C is the best language if you're wanting to solve problems that you know, and Lisp is the best language if you're wanting to solve problems you didn't know existed, or something like that, because it's so flexible. You can just start typing stuff and see what happens, and all of a sudden you've figured out some strange way of combining things and processing them. And I think a lot of people don't feel like, there seems to be this kind of interesting wall you have to cross. And on the one hand, people don't see that functional languages could be all that practical, and they think they're kind of maybe academic or something like that. And on the other side, there's people who are like, I can develop stuff 10 times faster with 10 times less code using this.
And it's a syntax thing, a lot of that.
And OCaml's really kind of fun because, in a lot of the functional languages, because you build the stuff that you want from the simple. But once you get to maybe some critical mass of code, if you build the first stuff right, everything else you build is just using those building blocks, and it's incredibly quick. Like, if you wanted to do, if you built the right kind of web framework for you, then everything you built could be very easy. Like, for example, I've been kind of thinking and started peddling around with this, making a OCaml web framework that was kind of based around a virtual DOM sort of thing, where you're just going to build, you know, I'll basically define what HTML is using disjunctive types. I can have an A that has an href and a URL. I can have a whatever that has a whatever, and then you can just sort of build this thing up, and then say, send it out, and it will build it up and turn it into HTML and shove it out, and then have something that can parse HTML, turn it into the abstract syntax, so you could read a HTML template, alter the stuff, and then send it out. I thought that would be really like a fun project to do. Kind of petered out and didn't finish it, but you know, it's kind of neat, because you could just take a stock website or page that somebody made, have partials, apply this partial into this thing, and then send it out. And I mean, if you put together a system like that, you're probably the only person who knows how to use it. That's probably the negative of doing some of these things, is you need the shop that you're wanting to do this to be really good at it and keep on with it, or it's probably a waste of time. But some of the places that do that kind of stuff, they probably can crank out work really fast once they get the tool set made. And they probably have guaranteed repeat customers, because nobody else would have a clue how to do it.
That's how you do business right there.
It's a new strategy for it,
yeah. I can't speak to OCaml or to Haskell for like some of the executables, but generally speaking, people, it seems in practice, OCaml compiles about the same speed, and in some cases faster than well-written C, because there's nothing wrong with any of the operations it does in the compiler is really good. So if you're doing a lot of, just regular kind of operations that aren't like trying to eat up a lot of memory for no reason, or you're building trees in a kind of normal way, you're going to have performance that's about as good as anybody could hand-tune the code to, which is generally not true of most languages. And there's a lot of effort that's been spent on making it so you can use other language routines in OCaml. You can build extension modules that use C or whatever else too. Which is kind of, it's sort of obnoxious to me and sort of cool, because at one time, one of the first big projects I ever did was, it was an audio processor, and everything that was there for loading files was a wrapper for libsound.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's not fun. I want to do it myself. There's really not anybody who's ever written something that natively loads the files. So I did not take the libsound wrapper approach and, you know, decided it would be able to read files that were really basic formatted. But there's a lot of stuff that's out there that's wrappers on existing libraries. So if you want to read sound things, read JPEGs, read whatever, there's plenty of stuff out there, and then you can do your functional thing with it. It's almost always like if there's something that gets done that's not functional, it's the part that has to do with IO.
Yeah.
Everyone's fine with IO being C. They're not interested in doing it. And surprisingly, OCaml is a really good system programming tool. The system utilities for like forking and executing commands and all that sort of stuff is extremely good in OCaml. I personally don't understand why it's not used as a systems tool more than it is, but I think its use as a systems tool is about zero. But it'd be a pretty good one.
This guy on the right hand side, Clayton, you seem to fan Tmux. I'm not familiar with that. Is it a?
Just lets you, it's a session manager first and foremost, which means that, like, if his session died right now, if you like exit out of this browser, you could get back to this pretty quickly. But it also lets you divvy up your screen into panels. He's got one on the left and one on the right there.
Yep, and you have key controls.
And he has some sort of Vim plugin that I need to apparently get on top of that lets him send his snippets from the left to the right.
Okay, I guess that's what I thought was part of Tmux, but that's okay.
Tmux is just the terminal multiplexer plus, like, you can, oh gosh, how do I have these set up? If I want a new session window, then you can just do a, I don't know why it kind of screwed up on the size, but you can just create a new one, maybe LS or something, and then you think you're done with it.
Get back
to these other ones. If you want to, split it up more, then you can split it up more.
Yeah, you can split it horizontally and all that jazz.
Did you use Tmux?
Yeah, I just started to. I used to be a screen guy, but apparently there's...
We'll work on different projects, so they'll have kind of a session per project.
Yeah, that's
with a few different things I've heard.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's great for SSH if you are SSHing into a dead machine and you don't want to have maybe a production ready stack running. You just want to have like six dev tools running at the same time in a Tmux session, and you don't want to lose it ever.
I'm fairly new to using Vim Slime with it,
so
but
I
it's
use that,
awesome.
But yeah, that sounds pretty cool.
Especially, I think, for some of this, like, debugging. Because if you were debugging entirely over here and you wanted to, I don't know, you have some function bob of x and it matches x with 1, return 5, matches it with 2, return 7, anything else returns 9. Stupid function, but then you could say bomb 5 and get 9 or whatever. But what if you messed up? I mean, it's kind of annoying to, you know, you accidentally hit the up arrow
and, but you've just got Vim on the left instead.
You've got Vim on the left, so so what if you screwed it up? Just type it right and save it.
Yeah.
And it's very configurable for how you want to send the thing over there. Oh, that's not going to work 2 o'clock. That's, yeah, that's nice. That Vim slime pick is nice. And I will push out this repository, which has, come on, you. In the README, it has something about Vim slime.
Okay, cool.
And then this guy here, he just,
that's
your settings, starts it. Yeah, he starts it, splits it, and in this case, the guy on the right, he runs utop to REPL.
That's cool.
And then the argument is whatever the file you wanted to edit with Vim. And so you can just be, I don't know, I guess you could you could edit the README and attempt to send it to the REPL unsuccessfully. I thought it would be kind of, I was going to just have it be like a single command that had it baked in, but that seemed pretty inflexible.
Mm-hmm.
Probably want it to be some cheesy command like this, and then you could really stuff it over like in user local sbin or something that's in your path, and then you'd have this like little vertical view widget whenever you wanted. And let's see, there was something else that got said to make the magic work correctly. You have to tell Vim slime what you want to do. And then it, by default, whenever you try to send something, it asks you what pane and window and whatever.
Oh, okay.
So I set the default config for it because I decided I was not wanting to do that every time.
Every single time.
Is slime a phrase that I should know? Is that like a common phrase, or is that just a? So this get the GitHub repo for Vim slime. This description is a Vim plugin that can use some slime.
Slime was
the thing I'm supposed to know. Or
tells you a whole lot. Maybe it's, you said it was an Emacs plugin originally. Maybe it's popular or something.
It was an Emacs plugin that did the same thing, I think. And then the Vim community decided that is way cool. We must have one. And it's funny because there's like 10 variants on that that I've seen. And it's fun to read the code for it because it's really stupid. It's like bind control C with get the current paragraph, send it to tmux. There's not much going on in Vim slime the plugin. And it works with screen too.
Right. So you're, that's a screen session right now and you're using tmux inside of it?
That's what they claim. Is that these their little window manager looking thing is sort of buttered
just
up
on
screen.
Screen. Gotcha, some sort of JavaScript layer over screen.
And I, the only thing I can attest to is that if you're using coding the way it is with screen or whatever they're using for their like little tab window manager looking thing, it completely hoses up the key bindings for the default Vim slime. You totally have to change the key bindings.
Not for tmux though. Tmux is control B, everything else though.
Yeah, tmux works.
Is it control W in screen? Something like that?
I don't really do screen.
Yeah, I used to do a lot of screen, but then I guess people stopped working on it.
The one thing I really like is I know control W if you split this.
Yeah.
I
circle split. Or,
yeah. And this, I think this is like a super duper thing. If you're a Vimmer, is not forgetting that Vim will split the screen, because how are you going to copy from tmux to tmux as easy as yanking and switching up and pasting?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's sweet. That's much nicer in certain situations.
I suppose, though, you probably have the option with Slime, since you can send it to the other thing, that you could probably somehow
yank and paste to another
paste,
Vim.
Yeah.
That sounds dirty.
Send an eye on the front of it to make sure. Sounds fit for trouble, but somehow I bet you could get it to do that. Because I like, personally, I like two tmux panes more than split Vim. But
yeah, I'll just split them and then do another tmux pane when I, as I need. But yeah, the problem I have with any sort of, you know, browser shell and Vim split is that Control W wants to exit the window, so I just close out of my workspace, which is one of the reasons tmux became important.
I like tmux. Tmux is a great tool. Anyway, y'all install tmux, then you'll have tmux. Then if you run it, it gives you this little dealy at the bottom telling you about your screens. And if you want a new screen, where did the thing at the bottom go? I don't know. The thing at the bottom vanished, but we've got screens, and you can get out of screens, create new screens. You want a throwaway screen to do some whatever in, just make a new one and then throw it away after. And I guess, you know, if you want to split screens, you can, what am I doing wrong? You can, I forgot my keybind.
Yeah, I forget them every now and then. I can't keep a cheat sheet.
You can split the thing and then split it again and then split it again. And, you know, maybe you want top running over there. And
looks like your vision.
All I see is blonde, redhead.
But it can be very handy, since you can do the same as all keyboardy.
Have links in one. Say, so how'd you flip those like that?
Oh, I just killed the top one.
Oh, okay. Gotcha, that makes way more sense.
I'm no power user. I know you can't do that.
Yeah, you can do some crazy stuff.
And I don't know why. I guess it must be a coding screen kind of thing, but I can't get real consistent results with some of the key bindings either.
Yeah.
But, whatever. Yeah. Don't really resize them very much. Either split it or don't split it. And
yeah, that's generally okay.
And I don't ever really do too much with other people, but you can connect to an existing session and have like two people, like if there are a few working on something, share a session.
That's really useful.
What I found was kind of a nice thing is if there's a, what in the heck is that thing's name? There's a product called MASH, which I don't remember what it stands for, but.
Is it MASH?
Mosh, that's it.
It's mobile shell.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Which will keep the session, finagles around keeping a session open.
Yeah. Even if like the IP changes.
Yeah,
and
all sorts of crazy stuff happens. Like you get on the train and you shut the laptop, then you get off somewhere else and you open the box and like you're still connected. And like Mosh plus Tmux is a pretty nice kind of combo because you have all your crap running. And then you like open it up later and it's basically still there. Yeah.
You just run your server on your phone.
Uh, I am not quite sure what's happening this next time. Here's some ideas that I had a while ago. I was thinking it'd be fun to do this web framework OCaml thing, but this seems to have kind of slipped off my personal radar, so I kind of am not leaning in that direction. Something that seemed like it'd be real fun to do would be some kind of neural network thing in OCaml, like recognize the postal 0 to 9 digits or whatever.
I don't entirely know what that means.
Well,
but I saw it in Silicon Valley, so I think it'd be awesome.
There's a data set of digits that originated, I suppose, with the post office. That's just the 0 to 9, I guess, for doing zip codes and stuff. That seem to be probably one of the most prolifically used things for training neural nets, because it's not an incredibly large collection of things, and they're not incredibly large pieces of data, so it doesn't take horrendously long to train things. And apparently, like, really good neural nets are better than any person at doing that. Because some of these, I've seen these characters that are the ones that nothing gets right. And it is not clear in the slightest what character would be. But somehow, there is an actual answer for what it is. And so you can tell if it's right or wrong. But they're often used for training and validation. And so maybe something like that. I was thinking it would be fun to try to do a neural net monad, just because, why not? See what you could do with that. And that's what I'm leaning on, is I think that would be a real fun one. Something that's like, let's do a neural net thing, see how you kind of do neural nets in general, and then do it in sort of obtuse language. But I have seen some things that were done in functional languages for that kind of thing. You could make a very elegant looking product that way. So I thought that might be fun. And then it seems like it would be fun to do like these skill drill things. I don't know why I think that's fun, but like you come in and it's like graphs, traversing graphs. We must traverse graphs. And it's just like, just like a skill drill skill builder, more than the presentation of like just kind of hammering in like, how do you do depth first? How do you do breadth first? How do you do quick sort and merge sort, whatever? Just to keep people's skills up on like how to do it, because they're important and
most
easily,
like,
forgotten.
Last session, kind of, right? Like the binary search trees.
Mm-hmm. Except maybe less like, I was thinking less like really digging into it, and more like, just
here's,
sort of
here's the algorithm.
Yeah, like here's, what are you doing if you're doing breadth first tree or graph search, you know? And how do you do it? Like, I'm at this node, what do I do, you know? And more like dialogue and participation and drawing on the board than the preaching.
Yeah.
Because I think it's important to try to use a group to really develop everybody and make sure skills are there, for me too, because it's easy to forget stuff. And it's one of those things that's always hounding on people if you're looking at something or you're wanting, you know, to do better at solving problems where you work, or you're wanting to go work wherever, you know, like those are pretty critical things to be pretty alert on, is like not fumble up like the graph traversal and sorting stuff. Just make, really just kind of drill on some of those things. But whatever everybody wants to do is a good thing.
I'm done with the neural network stuff.
Neural network stuff sounds good, yeah.
I'll schedule that for next month, for the next one.
Okay.
Or anything else. It does seem that anymore that there's a lean going on towards functional here. I am okay with this. I think it's fun. Is that something that anybody has a problem with? problems with. Not that it won't shift back, but.
No, I don't have any problems with that.
Okay.
Great. Thanks for the talk. It's good.
Sure. Thank you. I'll post this sometime soon, next day or two.